Good morning and welcome. I am so pleased that you are here on this beautiful day that our Lord God has made. And as we come into this place and gather in beloved community, whether you are joining us here in person in the sanctuary or you're joining us online in digital community, I hope that you know that no matter who you are or where you come from or wherever you are in your journey through life, that you are loved unconditionally and steadfastly by God, that you are welcomed so extravagantly for who you are and who God created you to be here at Park Church. And as we worship, we lift our songs, we offer our prayers, we gather in friendship here in this place, it is my hope that you are not only able to rejoice that much more in this day, but that you know and you feel the presence of the risen Christ in your midst. Yes. But now let us, friends, let us join our hearts and our spirits in unison at this time. Let us come together in beloved community to lift our songs and offer our prayers as we join today to worship God on this, the 12th Sunday following Pentecost.
Good morning. Would you join me in standing in body or in spirit as you're able and share our call to worship, our hymn of praise and opening prayer together? Children of God, welcome.
Welcome to this place of hope and
perseverance. God invites all of us to share in the good news.
We are welcome just as we are. We are loved just as we are.
In gratitude for all of this, let us worship God.
Thank you.
friends, let us now go to God in a word of prayer, invoking God's Spirit and inviting God to be with us in worship in this time. Liberating God, we give you thanks for sending Jesus among us to bestow upon us the freedom that life is with you. We bear you with us in this time of worship and open our hearts, our minds, and our bodies and our souls to receive this freedom and to live into it, to be bold witnesses of your abundant life to a world bowed down in suffering and brokenness. O God, make us channels of your peace so that we may be bearers of your transforming reign, and may we be drawn more and more into your peace and into your glory. We pray this in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus, our rock and our redeemer, and all of God's children said, Amen.
Friends, as an open and affirming church in the United Church of Christ, we believe that membership ought to be open to any and all who desire to publicly affirm their faith and declare a covenant with this local congregation. Some join by transferring their membership from a sister UCC congregation to Park Church, or are transitioning into this UCC congregation from a different Christian denomination. Others have been led to join as an affirmation of their faith in God. Regardless of the path that led them here, they all come into this time to claim their covenantal relationship with God through Christ Jesus and the member of this local church. And as we rejoice alongside the Holy Spirit that they have heard and answered such a call, today we receive one new member, the Reverend Darryl Kistler, who we have called into servant leadership as our new senior minister. Reverend Kistler joins as an act of solidarity and kinship with us, but also to fulfill a key provision that will allow him to transfer his standing into the Grand West Association of the Michigan Conference of the United Church of Christ. This also is the first step needed to be done so that we may have the installation ceremony in the not too distant future. Questions. Darryl, do you desire to join this local congregation, First Park Congregational Church, that has been formed in Christ's name?
Did I hear you say, do I deserve to? Did I hear that?
No.
I heard, do I deserve this? I do. I do deserve this, Dennis.
You do. For sure. Do you renounce the powers of evil, and will you strive to live out God's peace and steadfast and eternal love for all peoples and all the creation?
I do.
Do you covenant to endeavor to be Christ's disciple, to follow Christ's way of mercy and grace, to resist evil and dismantle oppression in all forms, to strive for justice, and to love God and neighbor?
I do, with the help of God.
Do you covenant to continue to nurture and grow your faith, to participate in the ministry and mission of this church, sharing regularly in the worship of God, holding the members and friends of this church in your prayers, and serving the least of these in our midst?
I do, with the help of God.
Let us, the members of Park Church, express our welcome and affirm our mutual ministry in Christ's name. Please read with me. We welcome you with joy into the common life of our congregation. We promise you our friendship and prayers as we share the hopes and labors of what it means to live into beloved community. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we all continue to grow together in wisdom of God and love of Christ. And may we bear witness to the peace and justice of God's realm on earth as it is in heaven. Members of and friends of Park Church, I present to you the newest member of Park Church, the Reverend Darryl Kistler. Now let us conclude our reception of a new member by going to God in prayer. Loving God, we thank you for calling us to be your servant people and for gathering us into beloved community. We are blessed by the Reverend Darryl Kistler joining our congregation as a member. We pray that you would bless us and inspire us as we walk this journey of faith together.
Friends, let us now go to God in a word of prayer, bringing our joys and our celebrations, our trials and tribulations, our concerns and our worries for ourselves and our families, our friends, our community, our city, our nation, and our world. Let us go to God as our ancestors have done for millennia, leaning into God's grace, and into that hope that God not only hears, but works in us and through us to answer our prayers. So let us begin by going to God in a word of silent meditation and prayer so that you may lift up your own individual petitions and intercessions to God at this time before I offer a prayer for the people, concluding with the prayer that Christ taught his disciples to pray. So let us go now to God in prayer. O loving God, make us a channel of your peace. and be close to us as we worship and help us to reflect the love of Christ in our lives. Oh God, we may not always be aware, we may not always recognize your presence, but we thank you for your abiding love, for the ways that your beauty blesses us, how your mercies have seen us through. We thank you that you live in us and you show us your love and your grace in us. So we come praying this day knowing that you hear us better than we are speaking, leaning and trusting in your abiding, steadfast love. We come praying for those who seek your face in times of sickness and ill health, who long to feel your healing presence intimately in their lives. We pray for our friends, our family, the people of our world who are still fighting and recovering from COVID-19, from those battling cancer, for those living with HIV and AIDS, for those struggling with the ailments of Alzheimer's and dementia and Parkinson's, those ailing from monkeypox, those who are wrestling with their mental and emotional health. Pour out your healing grace upon them, O God, and bring them to the fullness of health. We pray for all who suffer under the powers and principalities of the world. We pray for a continued reformation and transformation of our own country from the sins of racism and xenophobia and anti-Semitism. We pray for those who are caught in the midst of the violence of war. Help us to beat every spear into a plowshare so that we may use our technology not to take life, but to enhance life. We pray for our planet, buckling under the weight of our greed and our lack of concern. Help us to remember our commitment to be stewards of your lands, your seas, your air, your creatures. And guide us in our efforts to care and tend for your children in need, those without a home, without enough food, without adequate health care, those living in poverty and marginalized and being neglected. We pray for those who are grieving and mourning this day. May they know the grace found in every single tear shed and cherished memory recalled. And may they know your abiding presence as they journey through this grief and loss. And we pray for our children, our families, our educators, our school leaders, the staff, as the new school year begins. May it be one of wonder and growth and exploration. And may they be safe physically, emotionally, and spiritually. O loving God, help us to be channels of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us bring love. Where there is despair, let us bring hope. Where there is sadness, let us bring joy. So that together we may live in your spirit, building each other up, sharing the joyous work of Christ and serving in his name. This we pray, O God, along with the prayers of our lips and the meditations of our hearts, in the name of Christ Jesus, your Son and our Redeemer. We come bringing these prayers to you, because he taught us to bring everything to you in prayer when he taught us these ancient and sacred words to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. May your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. Our scripture reading this morning is from Luke chapter 13, verses 10 through 17. Now Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spiritual infirmity that had caused her to live bent at the waist for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Woman, you are liberated from your ailment." When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath day." But Jesus answered him and said, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" When he said this, all of his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
The person that I refer to as my pastor, the Reverend H. Edwin Middleton, just retired for the second time. He tried to retire back in 2015, but it really didn't take. But this time, it looks like his retirement is going to stick. Now, I met Ed way, way back in 1998 when I was a first-year seminary student. And little did I know when I met this man that he would become so important to my life. So let me just stop right here and say, if you do not have a mentor, find one, because they are vitally important to us. If you already have a mentor, reach out and thank them, because they have been incredibly important to you. Do that today. Don't wait. Do that. Little did I know back in 1998 that he would become my friend, my mentor, my pastor. So when I refer to as my pastor, when this pastor needs a pastor, I reach out to Ed. Let me describe him for you just a little bit. Ed is a big, big man. He's about 6'5", and he has this thick North Carolinian accent. He has a very strong handshake, and he gives full-on bear hugs, and he is full of witticisms that come from growing up in the South, and when he laughs big, and it fills up a room. To this day, he carries a massive beard on his face, and he is an exceptionally poor dresser. He is unkept and untucked. I don't think the man has ever owned an iron. He looks more like Hagrid from Harry Potter than any minister I've ever met. And for all the years that I knew Ed, all the time that I worked with him, he kept a framed sign in an 8x10 frame on his wall. Inside that 8x10 frame is a white piece of paper with large red letters that look to be handwritten, but they are written in a way that it's very easy to read. And those handwritten red letters form the words, "Never let your morals get in the way of doing the right thing." I saw this sign for the first time, and so I asked Ed about it. And he said it was a variation on a phrase that he read in a biography about St. Francis. See, St. Francis, before he was a saint, had defied the orders of the Vatican, of the Pope, and he went ahead and met with the Sultan Malik al-Kamil, at which place he negotiated a peace settlement to end the Crusades. The peace settlement was rejected by the Vatican, thus prolonging the Crusades for decades, causing thousands of people, soldiers, and innocents to die. And Francis is reported to have said something along the lines of, "One must follow one's own conscience because it is in one's conscience that God speaks righteousness," which Ed then took and turned into a more, you know, local colloquialism of never let your morals get in the way of doing the right thing. Ed gave me some sage advice that I keep to this day. He said, if you stay in this minister business for too long or long enough, one day you'll realize you're not called to do the moral thing or the ethical thing. You're called to do the right thing, the Jesus thing. And the right thing and the Jesus thing doesn't always mesh with a person's personal morals or ethics, but it's still the right thing to do. Never let your morals get in the way of doing the right thing. You can almost hear these words coming out of Jesus' mouth that day in the synagogue when a woman with a spiritual infirmity so heavy that it had broken her in half for over 18 years is healed by Jesus. But not everyone was thrilled by that healing event. As soon as Jesus loosens this broken woman from her spiritual and physical ailment, the leader of the synagogue, someone of my ilk, voices his displeasure with a great deal of indignation. Paula read that so well. I loved how your voice changed when you went to the leader of the synagogue. He's not unhappy that she was healed. That he's actually okay with. But Jesus had broken a rule, a sacred rule, a holy rule. The leader of the synagogue says, there are 6 days out of the week in which work ought to be done. Come on one of those days and be cured, not on the Sabbath day. Now let me be clear. I do not find this leader of the synagogue to be an evil person. He's not evil. He just cares about good worship. He cares about practicing and keeping the tenets of the faith. He cares about honoring God by honoring the Sabbath and upholding the traditions of his spiritual community. He does not wish to deny this woman healing. He only wishes to delay it slightly to one more day. In a word, the man is a legalist. But what this man, this leader, misses in his legalism is the very heart of the Sabbath, the very heart of the faith, the very heart of the tradition. What this leader of the synagogue misses is the unrestricted compassion always trumps legalism in God's kingdom every single time. Let me put it mathematically to you. C is greater than L. Compassion is greater than legalism. We're talking about a compassion that doesn't cling to a tradition for tradition's sake. It doesn't cling to the bylaws for the bylaws' sake. It doesn't cling to a commandment for a commandment's sake. Jesus' type of compassion is compassion that consistently sees the body that is broken, the spirit that is broken, the soul that is broken before it sees the commandment, the law, the bylaw, the custom, or tradition that has been broken. And it doesn't matter what form this legalism takes. It can be the legalism that holds on to the validity of a three strikes law in any state in the union that perpetuates a cradle to prison pipeline in this country. It can be the legalism that twists the use of Christian scripture to deny a woman her right to vital reproductive health care services. It can be the legalism that forces people to present a certain type of identification to exercise their right to vote, thus blocking their full enfranchisement. It doesn't have to be out in society. It can be here as well. It can be the legalism of a church bylaw that says that only full official members of a church can vote at a congregational meeting, no matter that they haven't come to church in years, given a dime to the church for years, been part of a committee or served, given any time or talent or treasure for years, but the person who comes each and every week gives of their time, talent, and treasure to the full congregational life of this church, but isn't a full-time member, can't vote. Is that fair? Is that the type of legalism we want to lean into? Or is it the type of legalism that says the tradition of our church is we can't sing Christmas carols during the season of Advent because, well, it's not technically Christmas yet? Please tell me, by all that is good and holy, Patrick, that is not the tradition of our church. The guises may vary, but in the end, my friends, legalism in any guise deadens us towards God's glory and makes us blind towards our neighbor's suffering. It makes us, at worst, irrelevant, maybe petty, stingy, anxious, cowardly. Legalism strips us of joy, and it robs us of peace. And what is the antidote to such legalism? It is to never to let your morals or ethics or laws or bylaws or traditions get in the way of doing the right thing. I think this is why the broken and the hurting, the suffering, the disenfranchised came to Jesus in numbers, because they saw in him a person who wasn't concerned with piety and defending a religion. They saw in him a person who was concerned with them as people, as humans, as children of God. And it doesn't take much of a moral imagination to think that this is the reason, this is what compelled this woman to come to church to the synagogue on that particular day. Who is this woman? We don't know. What's her name? We've never heard it. What we do know is she is weary. She is bent over and quite unable to stand. There is something going on in this woman's life that is heavy, so heavy that it's a burden on her that will not allow her to lift her head to the sky. And yet, even so, she is resilient and courageous. She perseveres. Her resiliency pushes back on her infirmity. As the Reverend Dr. Otis Moss III of Trinity UCC in Chicago has said, this woman would not allow her condition to be her conclusion. Her infirmity may deny her the opportunity to lift up her eyes to heaven, but her ears worked just fine. And she would not be denied the opportunity to hear God's voice in Jesus. Now notice, this woman does not ask Jesus to heal her. She does not approach him. She doesn't say anything to him. It's Jesus that notices her. He is moved by her. He sees her. He does not ignore her. He sees her for who she is, a child of God, bound up in the oppression of suffering. Jesus recognizes her need and is moved with compassion for her, and he loosens her, liberates her in that moment. Jesus sees her before she sees him. And Jesus is moved by this person who, by the theology of Jesus' day, has been marginalized. And he moves this person from being socially expendable due to her physical disability, and who has been ostracized by her spiritual community, assuming that she's been cursed by God. Jesus takes this woman, moves her to the very center of the worship service, and Jesus displaces the tradition and puts it where it belongs. Off to the side. I imagine Jesus stopping in his sermon and stooping down on all fours, dipping his head low so that it's parallel with where her head is, so that she can finally see his face. And he reaches out his hand to her, and she grabs it. And Jesus says the thing that Jesus often says to people when he encounters the sick and the broken, the dying and the oppressed. You are set free. And together they stand up. And he helps her stand up straight, lift her head, and she praises God because she is on the loose. She's free. What is the freedom that Jesus bestows upon her? Freedom to work. With her body healed, she can now work, which means she can have economic dignity. She is free to join her community, make new friends. So she is now rewarded with social dignity. And she is free to praise God as she feels as she ought, which brings her spiritual dignity and the sure knowledge that she is blessed by God and a child of God. And in this moment of liberation, Jesus praises. And in this moment of emancipation, the woman rejoices. And in that moment of deliverance, the crowd goes crazy. But who doesn't? Oh, a person of my ilk, a religious leader who sees that laws are being ignored and decorum is breaking down, and that is something he cannot abide. He too is a captive, a prisoner of his own legalism. He's a fundamentalist who is afraid of change and the new thing that God is doing in his midst. So what does Jesus do with him? He's moved with compassion for him, and he tries to loosen him from his oppression, his legalism that is oppressing him. Oh, don't get me wrong. Jesus is frustrated with the man. You can hear the exasperation in Jesus' voice when he speaks to his colleague. But I believe Jesus has compassion for this man as well. Jesus tries to free him from his own legalism and his own fundamentalism by challenging his mindset, appealing to his better self. Ought not this woman, this child of Abraham, this child of God, who has been broken in half for far too long, be made whole and set free on this, the day of liberation we call the Sabbath? In other words, in the Darryl Kistler translation, Jesus says to him, calm down. You're being a jerk and hypocritical. You got your priorities all in the wrong place. You need to remember, my friend, never let your morals get in the way of doing the right thing. So, friends, what burdens do you bring to church today? What are you carrying that is breaking you in half, making you bend, making your shoulders hunch? What is the legalism and the fundamentalism of our society and our culture, of this church, that is preventing us from being able to experience joy and praise of God? And who do we see out in the world or in the pew next to us who's bound up in oppression and traditions and laws that deny them their full dignity? And can we be a place, Park Church, be a place where people come to be unbent and to be restored their dignity, to be loosened so they may praise God? Whatever you may be going through, wherever it may be, let me tell you, Jesus sees you. And it is Christ's desire that you have liberty this day. So over the next few months, we're going to be revisiting and revising and rewriting our bylaws. This is a noble endeavor, and it is vitally important. It is important for our legal status as a 401c3 in the eyes of the IRS and the state of Michigan. And it is vitally important for our good standing within our denomination, the United Church of Christ. And without us even trying, my friends, and despite our best intentions and the guidance of the Holy Spirit, as well as Dennis and myself, our little team who revisits and rewrites the bylaws, we're going to put our own brand of legalism and our own hypocrisy into it. It is inevitable through our best intentions. And then you're going to vote on it. And we're going to say, this is good. Not because we're malicious or evil, but because we're human and we're flawed. But then in the not too distant future, after we pass these good bylaws, a moment is going to arise, a situation is going to occur. Maybe it's a person who comes to our church who is bent and broken, who seeks the type of healing only being in communion with God through Christ Jesus can bring. And everything about that situation in that moment, this person is going to defy our bylaws and our tradition, and we're going to have to make a choice. And I pray that when that choice comes, that we, Park Church, will not be known as the church that follows the rules, but we're known as the church that restores people's dignity from all the broken and terrible ways that the world can deny a person their dignity. And I pray that we will be a church, a community willing to repent of our own hypocrisy and our own narrow-mindedness and our own willingness to embrace the new thing that God is doing in our midst. And I pray that we would never let our morals, our ethics, our laws, our bylaws, or our traditions get in the way of doing the right thing. The Jesus thing. May it be so. Amen. Friends, now is an opportunity to use the gifts that God has so blessed us with and to share them so that God may bless them, so that they may be gathered together and then shared as a way to uplifting our ministry, empowering our mission, and hopefully being the answer to someone's prayer this day. So as you are able and willing and so moved, we invite you to participate now in this vital and important ministry of our church, the giving of our gifts and offerings.
Join me in our prayer of dedication.
Healing Christ, we have heard that the woman Jesus healed was seen and known, especially in her brokenness. She is seen, and in this seeing comes a call to him, a healing touch, and a response of praise. Christ has called to the church as well. Our call, like that of Jesus, is to look about us and see, then to give of our time, talent, and treasure, whatever we have, to see and care for those bent over in body or spirit, and to offer healing to them. May it be so. Amen.
Friends, as our worship comes to a close on this, the 12th Sunday following Pentecost, it is my hope a word, a song, a prayer has lifted your hearts and filled your spirits and inspired you to participate in the healing, peaceful work of Christ in our midst and out into the world. But as our worship comes to a close, let us go to God one more time in a word as we lift up and we live into our common commission this day. Let us now go forth into the world in peace, being of good courage, holding fast to that which is good, rendering to no one evil for evil, strengthening the faint-hearted, supporting the weak, helping the afflicted, honoring all people, loving and serving the Lord, and rejoicing in this power of the Holy Spirit.